Please make Gesho. May the sacred presence of the one who said he would abide in his teaching be our guide. May we follow his glorious example and tread with unfaltering steps this noble path until we too shall attain enlightenment. All Buddhas throughout space and time, all honored ones, Bodhisattvas, Mahasattvas, wisdom beyond wisdom, Maha Prajna Paramita. Good evening again. This is our, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8th class in our precept series. And as we start off with sort of this last talk of the series, I want to acknowledge those who have presented on the precepts and have come forth to lead discussions on the precepts. And amongst this group are Monica and Dixie and Jorin and Shokai and Emily and Penny and Choan, Kemio, Peter, Taiko. That's a good number of people, and that really speaks to the wisdom of this group. And it really speaks to, the stability and the steadiness of the Sangha that so many can step forward and are familiar enough with this material to offer a presentation on a particular precept. It's not easy to put together something and offer it to Sangha and friends and peers and have them ask questions or engage in discussion. There's an element of vulnerability that comes with doing something like that. And so I just wanna say thanks to all the folks who step forward and give you a gesho. So looking at the Kyoji Kaimon, the 16 Bodhisattva precepts. Seems like a while ago we started off with the beginning, giving and receiving the teaching of the precepts. The great precepts of the Buddhas are kept carefully by the Buddhas. Buddhas give them to Buddhas. Dharma ancestors give them to Dharma ancestors. Transmission of the precepts is beyond the three existences of past, present, and future. Enlightenment ranges from time eternal and is even now. Shakyamuni, the Buddha of this world, transmitted the precepts to Makakasho, and he transmitted them to Ananda. Thus they have been transmitted down through the generations. This is the meaning of the transmission of living wisdom. Buddhas give them to Buddhas. Dharma ancestors give them to Dharma ancestors. It doesn't say Buddhas give them to, general regular folk out on the street. It doesn't say Dharma ancestors give them to, random people who sign up on the internet. Buddhas give them to Buddhas. Dharma ancestors give them to Dharma ancestors. There's an aspect of taking the precepts that really points to that aspect of becoming part of the bloodline of the Buddha. You see this. This is part of Jukai, and when people take Jukai or receive the precepts, they will get a Kechimyaku, which is a document that sort of shows, it's got Shakyamuni's name, and above it is this big empty circle, sort of the source. And then under Shakyamuni's name is Makakasho and Ananda, and it goes through all of the generations. And at the very bottom, it's got the preceptee's name, his new ancestor. And there's a red line that goes through all of the names and circles all the way back around to the source. And sometimes we talk about that as the bloodline of the Buddha, something very specific and tangible. But this beginning of the Kyoji Kaimon really speaks to this aspect of connectedness and this aspect of non-separation between ourselves and the Buddhas. That there is something that is the same between us. And we can say that that same thing is our capacity for enlightenment or our Buddha nature or whatever label we want to put on it, but there is something that is recognizably the same. There's something very sweet about that. I think when I came to practice, I was so filled with self-doubt and so filled with second-guessing myself that hearing these words, Buddhas give them to Buddhas, Dharma ancestors give them to Dharma ancestors, I just kept thinking, not me, how could, not, what? Like, I couldn't possibly, not me. It took a long time before I was able to read those words without a sense of shame or doubt or some sense of deficiency. And to see that each time, it's even funny to say each time we step forward, each time we embody our practice, each time, each moment we live our life, there is an aspect of Buddhas give them to Buddhas, Dharma ancestors give them to Dharma ancestors. There is something about simply living this human life that is connected to the life of the Buddhas. Siddhartha Gautama was struck by the trauma of seeing old age, sickness, and death where he hadn't seen them before. And that sparked him on his journey. And each one of us have been marked in particular ways that prompted us to start our spiritual journeys. In these ways, we're not different. I'm not going to claim that I've got the Buddha's all knowledge or his sort of cosmic powers of dividing the thoughts of others. But I'm also not going to say that I'm completely separate. This sense pops up also at the end of the Kyoji Kaimon. You know, last week, I think it was Teiko that spoke about the last grave precept, the do not defame the three treasures. But then after that, we have this last section, which also is so sweet and so beautiful. Within these precepts dwell the Buddhas, enfolding all things within their unparalleled wisdom. There is no distinction between subject and object for any who dwell herein. All things, earth, trees, wooden posts, bricks, stones, become Buddhas once this refuge is taken. From these precepts come forth such a wind and fire that all are driven into enlightenment when the flames are fanned by the Buddha's influence. This is the merit of non-action and non-seeking, the awakening to true wisdom. These 16 precepts are roughly thus, to be obedient to their teaching, accept them with bows. Within these precepts dwell the Buddhas, unfolding all things within their unparalleled wisdom. Once again, there's that sense of the Buddhas not being separate. They dwell here within the precepts. Just as for those who are studying the perfection of wisdom in 8,000 lines, we talk about the perfection of wisdom being the mother of Buddhas, the genetrix, that from which Buddhas arise. And it is within these precepts that the Buddhas dwell. We can take them up. We can use them to model our lives by. Within them, the Buddhas are close. There's no distinction between subject and object for any who dwell herein. That sense of self and other disappears. That sense of here is me and there is the universe gets thinner, gets more permeable. That sense that here is me with my sense of right and wrong, and there is that other person with their suffering, which has nothing to do with me, gets to be seen as illusion and delusion. Because we are all connected. And one person's suffering is my suffering. And my suffering ripples out and touches those of others. One person's awakening. And my awakening ripples out and touches that of others. There is no thing in this existence that exists in a vacuum. Actions have effects. Actions have consequences. And so with these precepts, we take up the study of causes and conditions. We take up the study of actions and effects. We take up the study of skillful and unskillful behavior and how we affect the world, as well as how the world affects us. All things, earth, trees, wooden posts, bricks, stones, become Buddhas once this refuge is taken. How could it be otherwise? Picking up this practice of the precepts, how could we not learn from everything around us? How could we not be touched by everything around us? These are our teachers. These things, sentient or insentient, working in the garden today for hours. I was very much aware of the stones, of the plants, of the puddles of water. And they taught me something. Walking through the puddles in my no longer waterproof boots, feeling the water seep into my wool socks. I could feel my, like, oh, not this. I could see my resistance. Oh, I gotta get some other shoes. I could see my planning for the future. I did order new shoes, by the way. But in that sense, this puddle of water is my teacher. It shows me my resistances. It shows me my tendency to say no first and be curious second. Oh yeah, there's that thing again. Let's see if we can reverse it. Planting teeny tiny little bare root strawberry plants, knowing that it's going to be below freezing. How do I take care of these? How do I make sure they're safe tonight? These little strawberry plants are my teacher. They don't even have leaves yet, just these dusty, dry little roots that go in the ground. The ground itself is my teacher. It tells me something. It teaches me something. I want things to be a particular way. Oh, the soil is heavy. There's a lot of clay. I should put more compost in. I wish it was lighter. The strawberries would be happier if something else was surrounding them. But these are the conditions I have. How do I work within them? Such a way to help these little plants thrive. What is the difference between the mind that says, let me add more of X to make it better, and the mind that says, things are fine. I trust things, you know, they'll live or they won't. Different mind states all come up because these little strawberry plants help me see that. From these precepts come forth such a wind and fire that all are driven into enlightenment, and the flames are fanned by the Buddha's influence. I love this sentence. That sense of, from these precepts come forth such a wind and fire. There's such a sense of movement and a sense of transformation sense of inevitability that comes with working with these precepts over time. From these precepts come forth such a wind and fire that all are driven into enlightenment. Driven into enlightenment. This is not a passive thing. We're not strolling into enlightenment. We're not wandering into enlightenment. Driven into enlightenment. I like that because I have so much inherent resistance. This driven is like, sometimes I need that push, right? I don't know about you guys, but sometimes I need that push. And the flames are fanned by the Buddha's influence. I've got help. I've got the Buddha there, nudging me on, driving me on. This is the merit of non-action and non-seeking, the awakening to true wisdom. I was talking about giving this talk today at lunch. Some of the residents were sitting on the back porch, and there was a fairly newish person to practice who was with us. I was talking about giving this talk, and like two of the residents just spontaneously uttered this last paragraph. And I got to this line, this is the merit of non-action and non-seeking, the awakening to true wisdom. And this newcomer said, what does that mean? What do you mean non-action and non-seeking? Like, what is the merit of non-action and non-seeking? And I don't think anybody ever answered this person. I think it was sort of like that Zen thing where we're just like, yeah, that's yours to sit with for a while. But there was a real sense of, there's a relaxation that happens when you stop trying. There's a relaxation that happens when we shift from thinking about these precepts and consciously taking them up to relaxing into them and letting them guide. And I don't know if that feels different for you when I say those words in your body, like if it feels different in your body between like consciously working with the precepts versus just relaxing into them, letting them guide your actions. There's a point at which you don't need to do anything, that skillful behavior naturally arises. Not necessarily in every situation, but it becomes more and more of a habit that skillful action arises. There's a way in which that at some point this just becomes a worldview or sometimes we say it sinks into my bones. It becomes such a support, such a scaffold that these precepts just sink into the bones. And they're there, they're available. These 16 precepts are roughly thus. I like that modifier, roughly. They're approximately like this. Because, you know, the way we think about Buddhist teachings, language can be such a hindrance sometimes. So these are roughly thus. We try to articulate them the best that we can. But even then, what we're able to articulate is an approximation. To be obedient to their teaching, accept them with bows. I think we celebrate everything with bows. It's such a beautiful, simple sign of respect. And there's so many ways to bow, just by putting hands together, or a nod of the head, or a bow from the waist, or a full prostration. Like, even a blink can be a bow. There's so many ways to say yes. So we've traveled these past 8 weeks through this Kyoji Kaimon, looking at each of these precepts, looking at the beginning and the middle and the end, the contrition at the refuges, the three pure precepts, the 10 grave precepts. And for those who follow this path of Zen, these precepts travel with us as we go through our lives. We take them with us, and they lead us. You know, we say this precept practice is part of what makes our form of Zen, Zen. We have our sitting meditation, and we have our precept practice. It really points out that sense of interrelationship, that sense of connectedness with all beings. And so I would encourage you, even though we put down our formal precept study after today, feel free to continue. You know, feel free to continue reciting the Kyoji Kaimana's practice or doing recollection at the end of the day as practice and just letting the day wash through you and find those places where a precept might have been maybe alignment with a precept might have been called into question. Maybe I could have done something a little more skillfully there. Maybe I could have done something different that would cause less harm. And we'll revisit these again next year. We study these every year. And I think every time we come back to them, we all have a slightly different view of what they are or what it means to work with them or how they show up in our lives. So with that, I think I'll open it up to questions, comments, discussion. It doesn't have to be like a formal question and answer. We've all studied these precepts for the last 8 weeks, and I'd be curious to hear from you how it's been and what you've enjoyed and maybe what could use improvement for next year.
Non-seeking, is that kind of like when you look for something and you are so focused on it that you miss everything else? So if you aren't seeking, you know, you find things that you weren't looking for.
I tend to think of non-seeking as really noticing how abundantly rich you already are. Non-action and non-seeking, it's just right here. It's just right here.
I really like how the people took on a precept. I hated to miss the sessions that I missed, but I really liked that because it was so much different flavor and perspective and experience. And I was going to say, well, it might be nice to have more time for discussion, but there were times when people didn't say anything. So I don't know, but really like that approach and engaging in that. People did a lot of work and gave all different kind of ideas that got me thinking after the talk, you know, which was really nice.
Yeah, I'm glad. It's a joy to hear from all of the different voices.
Well, thank you, everyone, for doing that. Maybe next year I will participate in that.
Ha, 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 ha. This is recorded. We'll remember that.
<I'd like>
We'll see where people are next year. Because who knows where life takes you.
Jishin, could you speak to to immaculacy as the Dharma treasure. Immaculacy mm-hmm. is several times in the Kyoji Kanon.
Mm-hmm.
I have a sense of my own, but I wonder what it really means.
What do you think it means?
I mean, I think of the AA stricture to keep your own side of the street clean, and mm-hmm. and how see, where is the other place that it's referenced? It talks about immaculacy in do not praise self or blame others. Is that the one? When they manifest the Dharma body, not even a speck of dust is seen upon the ground.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, I just, I have this sense of keeping your own life as clean as possible. But I don't really know what is meant by immaculacy.
Coming from a Christian background, to me, sin has a lot to do with it. That you, if you have sinned, if you have bad karma, it follows you around. And immaculacy is, from contrition, is the ability to let that fall away and act without it.
Oh, thank you.
That's my, I don't know what Joshin's going to say, but.
Thanks, Dixie, though I hadn't thought of it like that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was going to say there's a couple of different ways to think about it. That's definitely one of those ways. You know, I often think of, anytime I hear the English words like immaculate or pure, I associate those with a sense of emptiness. Especially sort of emptiness in terms of no self, or emptiness of deluded views, which speaks, that's very similar to what you were talking about, Dixie, in terms of negative karma, not accumulating negative karma or washing away negative karma. Does that help at all?
No, that's great. Thank you.
Yeah, I don't know that I'm giving those as definitive answers, but there are ways that I think of those.
Are there any definitive answers in Zen?
Very few.
Well, I'm kind of addicted to the Kyoji Kanon and the just the rhythm of the words.
That's one thing I have definitely missed during COVID times, is that capacity to chant together or recite together, because that it gets so embodied. And so having that rhythm of the words is, it's a shared rhythm. And, you know, it's nice in that the way we recite it is consistent with the grammar, like the punctuation helps with that rhythm. But there's also a way in which just reciting it again and again and again and again and again and again with other people, I would have a hard time not falling into that rhythm if I was trying to do it some other way. And I've missed that ability to recite with you all. We can hear the presenter on Zoom, but we can't hear each other. And there's an aspect of hearing each other's voices that is very important. You know, we do that with Fukan Zazengi as well, having that rhythm of recitation.
I agree with you, Jess, and I actually thought what might be good to do is when we read the precepts, like take turns, like each person present reads a precept and the next person reads another one. But I thought, well, that'll take a long time, but then at least everybody's getting their voice, you know, saying something, saying, reading the precept. I actually thought that might be better. But hopefully next year we won't have to do Zoom meetings. Be in person.
Of course, without Zoom, then we wouldn't get to see each other's pets.
That's true.
Well, it seems like there's, oh, were you going to say something, Penny?
Well, I was just going to say, I mean, talking about, well, a few things. One is I really enjoyed doing one of the precepts. It was very scary and I was really nervous about it, but it got me to delve into one precept and therefore I paid more attention in the other precepts. You know, because other people were doing them. So it was interesting. And also I was going to say with Zoom, I feel like it would be nice to have some in person and some Zoom, because there are people that we would not ever see, like Peter, unless he's gonna come over from Australia and come so, you know, I think that it's a mixture of, you know, Zoom has really brought people together in a different way.
Yeah.
And, but I do miss the in-person and I miss the chanting as a group. There's no way we can chant as a group on Zoom because of the delay and everything. So,
yeah.
But I really, I mean, the precept study this time was really special to me.
Thank you. That's sweet to hear. And I'm glad you took a risk and took on one of the precepts to facilitate. I cannot say how much I enjoyed just checking in with all of you about your precepts before your presentation and just like, just getting a sense of how you process and how you think about presenting something and facilitating discussions and just getting to know each of you a little bit better. It was very sweet.
Yeah, I enjoyed that also. I've never talked to you one-on-one. It was really nice.
I'm not as scary as people say I am. Maybe, who knows?
Yeah.
But if there's not more, I'm fine with having this end a little bit early and we can have an early night of it. All right. The universe is as the boundless sky. Just as the lotus is not wetted by the water that surrounds it, the mind is immaculate beyond the dust. Let us bow to the highest Lord. All Buddhas throughout space and time, all honored ones, Bodhisattvas, Mahasattvas, wisdom beyond wisdom, Maha Prajna Paramita. Thank you all for being here tonight, and thanks for your participation throughout the last 8 weeks.
Thank you, Jyoshin, for wrapping it up for us.
Yeah.
That was great. Thank you. I mean, the whole thing was great. So,
thank you. Good night, Joel.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
Night.
Hey, guys. Have a good hike tomorrow.
Yes, and Emily, we have to talk sometime.
Yeah, we'll talk. Let's talk Friday. Let's talk Friday.
We can talk on Friday? Okay.
Yeah.
Although I'm going to a memorial, sir. Two memorials.
Oh, you're going to two?
Two?
Oh. We'll talk Saturday.
Well, I don't know, I'll talk to you sometime.
Okay, I'm sorry you have to go to memorial services. I hope that.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad because I feel like I need some closure. Well, one of them is not a really close friend. One is a very close friend.
Mm.
So if I don't make it to the second one, it's not a big deal. But
these are important. Okay, guys.
Okay, well, you guys have a nice evening.
Thanks for hosting, Lexi.
Thank
you're welcome. What, Trish?
We're hoping to come see the play Sunday.
Oh, good. All right. Well, you know, I don't necessarily, I have a lot of stuff to clean up. So, but you know, you can always kind of walk on. I usually come out really fast to start cleaning up. Don't go all the way out to the audience if you want to come and say something. That's okay too.
Okay. I will.
All right. Okay.
Good but night. Lexi's the best one in the play.
Yeah, definitely. Absolutely. Not just because you love her, but because it's true.
Okay. She was great.
Yeah. So, see ya.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Joy.